Okay, I'd like to call to order the first ever Phase 3 Climate Action Steering Committee. Yay, we got here. And I'd like to start off with introductions. And I think to make this easy, I'm just going to call your name out, wave, and we'll go from there. I'm Lisa Parshley, Olympia City Council. Cynthia Pratt from Lacey, and she's also, you're not the mayor pro tem, you're deputy mayor in Lacey, right? That's yes. Right. Okay. Okay. Ty Misner, Thurston County Commissioner. Yay. Aileen Swarthouse from Tumwater City Council. All right. Ramiro Chavez, who's the county manager. I was going to say city manager. Sorry about that. Pete Kmet, the mayor of Tumwater, who's the alternate for Tumwater. Brad Medrew is the staffer from Tumwater. Allison Osterberger is our TRPC staff person. Rick Walk is staffer from Lacey. Wave your hands. There we go. Jenica, I'm going to murder your last name. Machado, did I get close?
Machado.
Machado, okay. And I thank you. And then Les Tobias, who's also our IT expert. Okay, excellent. I'd first like to approve the agenda. Anybody want to move, or just do we want to do thumbs up if nobody's?
I'll move that we approve the agenda.
I'll second that, Eileen.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Okay. We're going to go right on to public comment. We all got a written comment from Lynn Fitzhugh. Did you all get that in your email box? Okay. Yeah. Les, is there anybody for public comment you see?
Not quite yet.
Are we there too quickly or?
We have four attendees currently. And currently Thad Kurtz and Tom would like to speak, Tom Crawford.
Okay. Well, how we're gonna do the public comment in the steering committee meeting is gonna be 2 minutes per person. And we're gonna do 10 minutes in the beginning. And anyone that did not get a chance to have their say in that first 10 minutes will come back to you at the end of the agenda. This is so that we can make sure that the steering committee has adequate time in each of these meetings to try to get what we need to get done in the next year, which is a lot of stuff. To call forward, Les, those... And how do you want to do the 2 minutes? Do you want to do the 2 minutes or do you want me to?
I have a timer here ready to go.
Perfect.
All right. So let's go ahead and I'm going to let Thad Kurtz speak and he'll be first up. Thad, you should be allowed to speak if you want to unmute yourself.
Okay. Can I appear too or just talk?
I think you can just speak.
Okay, we've now been creating plans about climate adaptation and mitigation for 3.5 years. We know there are significant steps that we could legally take to actually reduce our emissions. For example, we could adopt the ordinance Seattle just did, which put strict limits on using natural gas for space heating in new commercial buildings or multifamily above 3 stories and prohibits using natural gas to heat water in new hotels and large multifamily. We could adopt Seattle's ordinance regarding circuits for EV charging and new residential construction. I find it discouraging that we're putting off actually doing things that we know we could do in order to spend another year and another $180,000 discussing things we might conceivably do sometime. Before you spend $40,000 on the example white papers, I hope you'll consider some practical first steps. Ask the municipal lawyers that you already employ if you have the legal authority to take any of the listed steps about residential energy efficiency without state action. If you don't, then you can focus on lobbying before you worry about exactly what steps you might like to take sometime. Have a serious conversation about where you think you might get the land to actually plant 37,000 acres of new trees. If you can't answer that question, then it doesn't seem fruitful to explore trying to start a new carbon market program, especially since Bellingham and King County are already studying how to do this on land that they actually already have available. And you could see if they can figure out anything about how to do that before you spend money trying to think about it too. In short, I hope that you'll actually start taking some steps and you'll actually start thinking in practical terms about which of these ideas to pursue rather than simply marching forward with another year's worth of standard planning processes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Thad. Next up, we have Tom Coffer. Tom, you should be allowed to speak if you want to unmute yourself.
Thank you very much. And thank you, members of the steering committee and other folks who are here, for your ongoing work on this effort and your commitment. I'd like to start out just by reminding myself to some extent and perhaps the rest of you why this is a problem and why it's urgent why we should care about it. And the reasons are pretty straightforward, although there's a lot of complicated science, obviously, that goes into this. But the reason is that as we continue to emit greenhouse gas emissions, that has serious effects on people, not just in our community, but around the world. People are losing their homes through floods. We've seen what happened in Texas. People are dying. People are starving. Every day, and people will and these serious effects will continue, and they will continue to affect us. I think we've seen that the energy grid in Texas, for example, had serious issues with the weather that was created in large part because of the dramatic changes in the Gulf Stream that caused that very extreme cold weather to go down into Texas. So, and that's a clear result of climate change. So I just wanted to kind of get our heads in the right place and provide that kind of context, that this is serious, it's harming and killing people now, and it will continue to harm and kill people progressively as we go forward if we don't take action. And by the way, I would kind of echo that part of what Thad just said. You know, it's important for us to start to take action today, this year. At the same time, there are very significant benefits we get from taking action. We get significant utility cost savings on the part of our residents. We get significant transportation savings on the part of our residents. I've recently done a back of the envelope calculation. And by 2030, if we achieve the targets for energy efficiency in our buildings and for transport converting to cheaper transportation modes that are contained in the plan, we could save up to $100 million a year countywide on the part of our residents. We also get more jobs, we get more business opportunities, and we get improved health. And finally, I'd like to say, we at TCAD are not only willing and ready to help you in this task, we are already starting. So we are bringing, for example, realtors together to talk about issues with regard, their concerns with regard to making audit information, energy efficiency information available, either at point of sale or point of retrofit of a building. And we will continue to work in other areas of energy efficiency, transportation, and sequestration. So thank you very much. Thank you for your work, and we're here to help. Thanks.
Thank you, Tom.
Is there anybody else?
We do not have anyone else with their hand raised who would like to speak.
Okay. Does anybody on the steering committee want to make a comment, or do we want to go right into the agenda? It's fine if you do. Okay. All right, hearing none, we have a couple action items we do have to take care of before we can talk about things like phase three projects. The election of the steering committee officers, and we kind of did it unofficially last time and when we were still technically the subcommittee. So we wanted to bring this back to make sure that it was done officially. And we will start with vice chair and then we'll go to chair. So do we have any nominations for vice chair?
This is Carolyn. I nominate Ty Mincer.
Any other nominations? Any other nominations? Okay, hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Okay. Ty, will you take over the chair election?
Sure. At this time, I'll call for nominations for chair of the Climate Steering Committee.
I nominate Lisa Parsley.
Lisa Parsley's been nominated. Any other nominations? Going once, twice, three times, close the nominations. All in favor of Lisa Parsley being nominated as chair, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And I'll pass it to you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ty. Okay, let's, I would like to entertain a motion about the charter and then discussion after that, if there is any more discussion about the charter.
I'll move to adopt the phase three charter.
Second.
Is there any discussion, any changes at this point or any amendments? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor?
Oh, Madam Chair, this is Pete.
Yes.
So I just want to point out that the attachment to the charter does in fact include the white paper topics that the public comment was about. So I don't know if you want to talk about that now, or I'm not an official member of this committee. I'm just sort of back up to Eileen, but I just wanted to point out that if you want to change anything, then approving the charter sort of locks you into that. So I just wanted to point that out.
That's a good point. Thank you, Pete. And by the way, I hope it's okay if we use first names here, or would you rather have us go full title?
Pete is good.
Okay. My understanding, and Allison and Cynthia and Ty and Carolyn can jump in on this, that these were examples of potential white papers, but they were not definitively the papers. Now, I could be mistaken, so I'm going to step back and let other people talk.
I'll just say, and in the phase three interlocal agreement, it says, the scope of work says that the steering committee will confirm the white paper topics.
This is Cynthia. Mm-hmm. I'm not quite sure I heard you, Allison, because you broke up, but it sounded like you said those were examples of, is that correct?
Yeah, sorry if that didn't come through. I think the attachment that Mayor Komet referred to is the scope of work for the phase three interlocal agreement. And the scope of work, it's possible the one that's in there doesn't have the, I'll have to go check the language on that one. But the actual scope of work that you all have approved says that the white paper topics will be decided by the steering committee. So it doesn't, the adopting the charter doesn't lock you into the topics aside from that you're going to work on the white papers.
Correct. Okay.
Yeah, I would just point out the they look pretty specific, but it's because they wanted to give examples of the detail and scope of what would be covered, and it's spelled out in that fashion on page 11.
Thank you, Ty. Anybody else? But thank you, Pete. That might be confusing to someone watching based on the documents.
Well, I would just ask, I mean, I wasn't involved in establishing this list, so I don't know what, you know, how much thought went into it. And I'm not necessarily saying this is the wrong list, but it seems like now's as good a time as any. I mean, at some point, you know, and I believe this meeting, right, we got to give TRPC the charge to send them off and do some work here. So seems like, I mean, okay, fine, if you want to approve of the charter as is, knowing that that's not locking you in. But I think this meeting, I'm trying to look here and see.
Agenda item 2C, we do bring up the white paper conversation.
Okay, well, I mean, if you want to take it that way, then that's, sounds like that would work. So anyway, I just wanted to be sure that there is some discussion about that, good, bad, or indifferent. So anyway.
Okay, Cynthia?
I was just going to say is that there could be a time where we only do one or two white papers. It's the most critical if we need it at all. And so we don't want to be absolute about stuff until we kind of know where we're, how we're going to focus on things together. So I would postpone that at least till 2C and then make a decision about that, because there may be other things that are more critical for TRPC to be doing right now.
Anybody else? Eileen or Carolyn, any comments before we go to a vote?
I think what Cynthia's saying makes perfect sense. We need to get a little further down the line before we really know what we're going to want to focus on in the white papers.
Okay.
So just for clarification, these are just examples. Do they even need to be included in there, or why are they included in the charter and in the language, I guess, would be my question.
That's actually a good point. And it would be a little more clear to say, would it be possible to say these are examples? Go ahead. That's it. Examples, yes. Sorry. Thank you, Allison. Yes?
Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't believe that the topics for the white papers are included in the charter itself. The attachment is the scope of work.
Oh, yes, you're right. You're right. You're actually right.
So what all you're really approving with the charter is your norms, your organization, your decision making, those sorts of things. It does say in the scope of work, and that's why we have it on the agenda for later, that we'll go through the topics, because the topics for the white papers are at the steering committee's discretion. But the charter is just approving your rules for operation.
Thank you for the clarification. Okay. Are we ready now? Okay. All those in favor of the motion before us, which is to approve the charter, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Okay. Let's move on to 2C now, since there seems to be an appetite for that discussion. So we've got Allison, do you want to kind of tee up the documents you sent to us on this particular 2C?
Sure, and I have some slides I've put together that I can share, and then I can pull to walk through a little bit of the tasks, all of the tasks that are part of phase 3, and then we can have discussion or questions on any of those items. So phase three project expectations, can everyone see my slides all right? See you nodding. So just to bring people's memory back to the Thurston Climate Mitigation Plan, when you approved the plan as the steering committee, it was with this frame, overarching framework for climate action, that we would have these general planks of our climate framework, greening our grid, shifting energy sources, living lighter, storing carbon, building local capacity and resilience, and overarching all of that, ensuring we had an equitable distribution of costs and benefits. Phase three is this, and we've talked about it as this transitional year to dig into the specifics of what that work really means and understand what needs for all of you to understand what needs to happen at a regional level to move forward on this broader framework. So it has five tasks in the interlocal agreement: project management, this steering committee, policy research support, monitoring and assessment, and public outreach. And I'll talk a little bit about each of these tasks, and do want to get some feedback here from the steering committee on any questions that you have, your expectations for each of these tasks before we go ahead and get and start digging into them at the staff level. So task one, project management, includes a multi-jurisdictional staff team. That's staff from each of the four jurisdictions who will meet 7 to 10 times over the next year. And that's so that you can share information about what's working and not working in different jurisdictions, share opportunities. And the multi-jurisdictional staff team will also be responsible for reviewing materials and providing information for the annual reporting. This task also includes information sharing, so quarterly reports on implementation activities, some updates like we'll be talking about later today on things like ongoing legislation, funding opportunities, all those kinds of things. So that's all included in task one. Any questions about task one or things that the steering committee would like us to keep in mind as TRPC, as we start working on this task?
One quick question, Lisa. The multi-jurisdictional staff team, 7 to 10 meetings, I thought in the charter that that was also left to staff somewhat discretion about the ability if they can attend. Am I incorrect about that?
I think it might have been some discretion because there was concern about some of the jurisdictions, the staff having the work bandwidth.
Right.
That was my memory, but I think, and I could be wrong, staff's here except for mine, who's actually moving into Olympia today, so yay, that the number of meetings was agreed upon by the staff and that they thought most of the staff would be able to make them. Am I wrong, Allison?
That's my recollection. I think we talked more for these meetings, the steering committee meetings, about staff participation being optional.
Okay.
But we did reduce the number of meetings because of that concern for this yes. task.
Okay. Anybody else?
Task two is the Climate Action Steering Committee meeting, and we're having the first meeting today. We're set to have from between 6 and up to 12 meetings. And just a couple of things to just housekeeping things there. You guys have already approved approved the charter. The decision was made that we would hopefully schedule out all 12 and then decide if we need to not hold a meeting, and plan that way. It's on everyone's calendars to have 12 meetings, and then we can take a meeting off if we don't have anything planned. Right now, the proposal is to have a standing meeting of the fourth Mondays, 3 to 5 p.m., so a two-hour meeting at this time. This time we're meeting today would be the standing meeting. And the major charge for the steering committee under this task is to develop a longer-term climate mitigation implementation interlocal agreement. So right now the Phase 3 ILA is for 1 year, and what we'll be doing is looking at different governance examples, making some decisions about what if a longer term agreement is desirable and what should be included in it. Any questions or discussion on task two? And also I do really hope to be able to confirm this meeting time so I can lock it down on everyone's calendars.
I know there was some discussion of, should it be noon or 3? And then, to be right up front, Ty and I and Allison talked about it, and we both, all three of us, felt that we should be considering that this should be a two-hour block, just like the phase two at 1.5 and sometimes 2 hours was almost not enough. But the timing is, should it be 3 or noon? I'll leave that up to the committee.
Do you want a discussion now?
Do we want that now or later, Allison? And you, with the way the flow, now would be good. Okay.
Well, I'm raising my hand, but I think 3 to 5 works really well to me. One of the things about having it at lunchtime is that people are thinking about food, and then they're trying to fit, you know, get their food here and to, so they can sit down, and they have other things they do at noon. So I'm less comfortable at 12, but now if everyone else meets at 12, I'll meet at 12. So that's my take on it.
Annie?
Right now in Zoom world, 3 to 5 is great, but I'm wondering what it'll be like if and when we go back to our offices and stuff, what that'll look like. It's just, and I'm just throwing it out there, so, because you have to take time from work, how some of us have to take leave in order to be able to attend these meetings, so anyway, so I was just wondering how that affects the other people that are still working. So, but I'm flexible. You can do noon or 3. So,
okay.
Miss Carolyn, I'm flexible. Either time will work for me.
Ty?
I'm kind of with Cynthia. I vote for 3. I just think it's less hectic, and I can, you know, there's too much going on around noon, but I'm flexible and I'm happy to accommodate the majority.
Okay. Pete, do you have any weigh in on this one?
Well, either time works for me, but like Ty, I think middle of the day is tough. I mean, there's a lot going on during the middle of the day. So this would be better.
And who knows, Elaine, I appreciate that. And I know that Ian was worried about that a little bit, but she was going to intend to make it as many times as she could if it was 3, no matter what. It sounds like we have a consensus that 3, with the people that are thinking noon are not, have a burning desire. Am I wrong on that? Can I get thumbs up that it's 3? Okay, there you go, Allison.
Thank you. I'll get those meeting invites out. We'll be holding the steering committee meetings like today in a webinar format. I think it's just going to be a little bit easier. We'll get used to doing doing things the way we have. We've discussed with the chair and vice chair holding public comment at the start of the meeting so that folks have time to give comment. And we will send those public comments out to you in advance. But always, you know, we're all learning in the Zoomiverse. We can adjust things as we go forward and as we maybe even potentially start meeting in person again. We can come back and change things up so that if things are not working, so they can be better. So always feel free to speak up. If you as a steering committee member, you can bring it up to me and bring it up to your chair and vice chair if you think of something that you think would make these meetings work better. But we'll go ahead with that. That's really helpful to have that decided.
Allison?
Yes.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Go ahead. Sorry, Faith.
Before you go on to task three, so looking at my scope of work, there's a lot more listed under task two for the steering committee than what you've got on the slide. So I'm just wondering, why is there that disconnect?
Probably just because I didn't want to have a slide full of text.
Okay, well, I don't know.
So if you want to, do you have questions about the other things that are?
Well, I'm not sure what this exercise is geared at. If this exercise is, you said, for us to feel comfortable with what's in each task, I don't see a lot of what should be in task two. So it's hard for me to know if the group understands that we're doing more. This group is tasked with more than just creating the phase four ILA. We have, the white paper issue, reviewing those findings. I'm just listing the bullet points that are in the scope of work: progress toward achieving emissions targets, need for issue-specific work groups, adaptation of plan implementation. I mean, there's several things. There's a lot more on our plate. I just didn't want people to feel like that all this steering committee was going to be doing was dealing with the ILA, although that's a big piece.
Thank you, Ty.
My understanding of this task is more the meeting logistics, and they're getting paid to do meeting logistics minutes, that kind of stuff. And the ILA is one of the procedural aspects of this. So I think it was lumped in here. The other tasks are under a different, or the other things you mentioned are under different tasks. So they're not, this is not all the committee is charged with doing under this charter. So.
Okay, good. So I can share that, just confirming that.
I think one thing that we've talked about for phase three is having the steering committee. In phase two, we had so much to get done, and we were often bringing things forward to you to review and approve. And we want to create more space in phase three. Now that we're shifting to implementation, really reserve that space for jurisdictional sharing. So this is a real charge in phase three is for jurisdictions to be hearing from each other and coordinating on how to move forward. So there'd be more time reserved in our agenda going forward for each of you to bring forward things that you're working on in your jurisdictions and reporting out. So there would be that time on agendas going forward.
Yeah.
Any other questions or discussion on task two? Moving on to task three, which is, I think, probably what most people want to talk about. That's the policy research support. And the idea for this task is that there are all of these actions in the plan. We want to dive into them and need a little more work done to know how to move forward on some of them. And it is, the idea here is to dig into some of those policy questions, come up with some options and a viable path forward on these things. I'm going to walk a little bit. I know there are questions about why are these the four that were included in the scope of work, and I'll walk through that decision-making process. But the steering committee, you're welcome to come to a decision and suggest other topics, provided what we have, it will fit within our current scope of work. And we feel like we have the capacity under the current scope of work to do 4 white papers on topics of this level of complexity. And so for each of the white papers, the ideas there would be some background research, some looking around at case studies, what are other jurisdictions doing on these topics, developing some potential alternative pathways that we might move forward as a region on them, and looking at what the potential costs and needs would be for costs and the pluses and minuses of each of them. Those white papers will come back to you as they're completed, and you would make a recommendation as a steering committee on which of the options, how you would want to move forward. Those are things that we would be looking to include then in the recommendations at the end of this planning cycle, this year-long interlocal agreement. So that's an overview of the white papers. The topics that we proposed in the phase 3 scope of work are climate-informed decision-making, looking at energy efficiency options for residential buildings, looking at electric vehicle ready infrastructure, and looking at options for developing a regional program for carbon sequestration. And again, I'll walk through that, kind of where we got there. So if you remember in our discussion of the implementation strategy, or if you were looking through the plan for those who didn't participate in the steering committee in phase 2, in our implementation strategy, we first took the 72 actions and we put them in different buckets for how we might address them. 4 buckets were legislative agenda, regionally coordinated, individual jurisdictions, and supporting partner, depending on who might have the right authority or the right entity to move forward on it. For phase 3, we were really focusing on regional actions. You individual jurisdictions, maybe through your own programs and staff, working on those actions that were tasked for being best suited to individual jurisdictions. There are folks out in the community or partners who are working on the supporting partner items. But phase 3, for this part of the process, we're looking at the regional, but how do we get into those items, actions that we identified as needing regional coordination. And that includes the legislative agenda. So in the implementation strategy, which was included with your, which was adopted in the plan and included in your packet for today, I try to kind of break it out here a little bit, but there under the legislative agenda, there are a number of strategies, and then you can see the actions that fall under those strategies. And most of the actions that fell under legislative agenda had to do with energy efficiency. So there were a lot of questions that came up about what can, and you heard it in the public comment today, what do local jurisdictions have the authority to do around energy efficiency improvements? And so the idea with one of the white papers might be to unpack that a little bit and find out what can we do, what's going to be the most efficient way to move forward, what types of options are there out there, what type of legislation might we as a region want to work together to develop and promote at the state. So I think there are a lot of actions with really good ideas that are in the plan. And so this white paper, Energy Efficiency in Residential Buildings, would unpack that a bit. Under the regionally coordinated bucket, there were 9 strategies that we had. The first was to develop standard approaches to incentivize and track green building practices. There are a couple of actions that fall under that. This strategy is not addressed right now in the white papers or the scope that we have for phase 3. It's something, if you wanted to do that instead of another white paper, we could look at this strategy. But we just proposed looking at the energy efficiency question instead. Strategy B there was to develop standard approaches to consider climate impacts in decision making. So that was things like looking at the social cost of carbon. How can we incorporate, can we come up with some general rules for incorporating how we think about climate when we're making decisions on projects or in other ways? So that's one of the white papers, climate-informed decision-making, would look at some examples of how places are doing that and come up with a proposal for how we might do it regionally here. Strategy C is develop a model, regional standards or codes for priority climate actions. And white paper number 3, developing standards for electric vehicle ready infrastructure, would be looking at what are standards that we could develop regionally, and then individually jurisdictions could adopt them so that we have complementary or the same standards consistent across jurisdictions. That was kind of identified as something that we may be able to tackle in the near term and a high priority. Strategy D was addressing climate mitigation goals and actions in transportation planning. Many of the actions that fall under that strategy are covered by existing programs, so they're already being, climate work is already being incorporated into those programs. Strategy E is support and expand the food waste program. Again, that's an existing program that exists at Thurston County. Doesn't mean more work couldn't be done to look at what would happen next, but it wasn't, we didn't create a white paper around that. Strategy F, develop a regional program for carbon sequestration, was identified. And I think there were a lot of questions that came up about how this might work. And so we proposed doing a white paper number 4 around a regional program for carbon sequestration, which would include looking at afforestation, so preservation of trees, replanting and planting of trees, conservation, as well as prairie restoration and other forms. What are other people doing out there? What could we do locally? Strategy G was to monitor and report on the region's climate progress, and that's covered under task 4, monitoring and assessment, which we'll talk about in a minute. Ongoing strategy H was ongoing regional coordination, and that's covered in tasks 1 and 2 of the phase 3 interlocal agreement. And strategy I was keep the community informed and engaged, which is covered under task 5. So that's how we ended up with the 4 white papers that we have. And I'll pause there for questions, but also if there's any discussion from folks about whether these are the 4 white papers you'd like to see covered, whether there's something else that you would like to see, but we are looking for direction from the steering committee on this topic.
I know that Olympia has some opinions, but I'd like to open it up to the committee first to see if there's any other opinions on white papers as they stand or new ones. Cynthia. You're muted.
Sorry. I would like to see more focus on a white paper that does a regional kind of whatever we do coordination that would include if we do something regionally, such as making regional standards or codes or potential regional standards or codes for climate actions. We look in and look at the cost of that and what potential some of those codes would be. I think that regionally is what Lacey has a hard time dealing with, is figuring out what that means regionally. We could do it ourselves, but that it doesn't give that big regional approach that we are looking for in some of these actions. So that's one thing. And standard approaches, I don't know whether, I'm not exactly sure I quite understand what that means, because every jurisdiction has their real set way of going about doing that. So I'm not exactly sure what a white paper would do for that, or whether it would behoove us to each jurisdiction to tackle that kind of thing, because it's, I mean, we're way in the middle of doing stuff already and stuff. So standard approaches may not work for us, but I'm just saying that to be really honest about it. So that's my opinion. And I think coming up with what we do decide and kind of helping look at potential range of costs is a really big thing and important, because that helps prepare. We can say we set aside $100,000 to do all these hookups or whatever it takes and stuff, but we need to kind of know how much in our budget we're looking at.
I saw Ty's hand up. Ty, did you?
Yes. So as a starting point, I want to make sure that I'm on the same page as everyone, because I might be the only one that wasn't part of the original steering committee process. So I've got my binder, and I had appendix 10.3 blown up into big paper so I could really read it. And I want to make sure that I'm working from the same set of parameters as everyone else. I've heard of 72 strategies, but appendix 10.3, I counted it up, it has like 240 line items. But then this list on this slide doesn't seem to be, it seems to be pulling from some other type of strategy list, because it doesn't seem to match up to what I was working through. So anyway, that's a preliminary comment, and I hope somebody could clear that up for me. But as far as the white papers, my interest, I mean, I think the four that are there are, let me double back. So when I'm looking at these, I'm very interested in, you know, what we need to coordinate on a regional basis, but I'm confused by this list. Like H says ongoing regional coordination. So an item of regional coordination is regional coordination. That doesn't even make sense to me. So I'm trying to parse through, and again, I was parsing through hundreds that are in appendix 10.3 and sort of looking at where we would need to do things the same. I sat in on this, on the work session that Tom Crawford referenced in his public comment, as I think the rest of you did. And one thing we heard from Master Builders, it was Master Builders, I think, that was really clear. And the builders from up north were also there. And they said, whatever you're going to do, just do it the same. Like, don't make us work with one set of rules in Tumwater and one set of rules in Lacey. That was one of the big takeaways that came up multiple times. So that's what I'm understanding kind of is for us to identify those issues that really need to be the same if they're going to work, like green building incentives or whatever it might be, and make sure that we're focusing attention on it, whether it's a white paper or a subcommittee, or we're enlisting TCAT to pull a stakeholder group together like they're already doing with point of sale energy efficiency audits. I think at least the jurisdictional partners here are familiar with the TCAT proposal for a clean energy program, regional clean energy program that the county allocated money for and proposed that maybe the other jurisdictions would kick into. Maybe something like that. There's literally 59 strategies in appendix 10.3 related to energy efficiency in buildings. So I think we're going to need help. And I just want this group to sort of maximize our scope of what we can do, leveraging all the energy we have in the community, and not think that we're going to solve everything with four white papers by TRPC, but think about which, you know, have those white papers fill gaps that we can't fill somewhere else. I feel like there's a lot of energy in the community around the building stuff. There's a lot of webinars. The folks up in Seattle, People for Climate Justice, they put on a series of webinars. I attended those. Chris Van Dalen and TCAT have been doing things here locally with our local stakeholders. So I think we need to think about how we can energize and use that work, And then maybe the white paper fills some other gap. I like the one about carbon sequestration. I like the one about EV ready stuff. I think those two make sense because I'm not sure, I'm not hearing a lot of other work being done. But when it comes to energy efficiency in residential buildings, I'm not sure that, I think we might be able to use other groups and resources to get some of that work done. Anyway, that's a lot. But I just like to understand when folks are talking about the 72 strategies, where should I be looking for those versus what I see in appendix 10.3 or what I see up on this slide?
Eric, could I respond just to that question?
Yes, yes.
So Commissioner Mensert, appendix 10.3 so there were a lot of work products developed over the course of the climate mitigation plan. Appendix 10.3 has the community-wide action list. It's the long list of actions that was developed early in the process. So it's the kitchen sink. That's why it's huge. It's every action that everyone proposed that we went through and looked at. And then we went through a process of narrowing down and prioritizing the actions. And we ended up on the 72 actions that are in the final climate mitigation plan. And that's all part of that multi-criteria analysis appendix, if you want to get into that. Which appendix is it? I don't have it in front of me. I think it's four, appendix 10.4 or 10.5, is the implementation strategy. And that is when we went back and looked at, okay, we have these 72 actions. What do we need to do to get there, to get these done, to start breaking them down into workable chunks? And the implementation strategy, and I'll stop sharing my screen. I'll pull up that.
That was 10.6, Allison.
10.6, I was going to say.
10.6, sorry, yeah. When I have the screen up, I can't see it. But that's in the materials that were sent out to you. And that one is attachment 3.
Well, she's calling that up, Ties. I remember, and the steering committee members who were with me can correct me if I'm wrong. We didn't want to lose any of the 200 or 300 plus potentials, because if, you know, at some point we want to adjust the 72 or one of those suddenly become very doable, you know, we wanted to make sure we kept the community's work, especially as if this works, the plan works, we will be adjusting as we go, as we finish things.
Exactly. So the implementation strategy just looks like this. We broke out again into those buckets: legislative agenda, regionally coordinated, individual jurisdictions, and supporting partner for kind of who would need to take it on. And we just kind of lumped like actions sort of together under these different strategies. So most of the B1 strategies, which are all about residential energy efficiency, the jurisdictions had questions about whether they had authority to move forward on them, on things like property tax credits and incentives and things like that. And there were a lot of, so all these ended up in the legislative agenda. And then we looked at actions that could be regionally coordinated. So developing standard approaches for green buildings, standard approaches to considering climate impacts in decision-making, developing monitor, those are all, I think, responding to that ask that we heard from the master builders and others in the community, from stakeholders saying, if you're going to move forward on this stuff, we really want you to be consistent with how you do it. And so a number of things where we identified that it might be good to develop a single way of doing it that each of the jurisdictions could then take in and adopt through their own processes. So a lot of things ended up, a lot of specific actions ended up into that regional bucket.
And is it your intent with this white paper to go through each of these and sort of flesh them out a little bit more?
So it is, I don't feel like we've got enough in the scope to do all of the everything that's in there. But we have enough to do the four items that we identified. And if you look at that, the scope of work for the phase three ILA, it lists out which actions fall under each of those white papers.
So the one about codes and I can't remember how it was worded, but
model codes, yeah.
Yeah, that to me is what the master builders are somewhat asking for, is coming up with potential regional codes that could be implemented and stuff.
Yeah.
So Allison, now that I'm looking at the right thing, I'm still counting, and I see where you've got regionally coordinated, and I'm still counting 22 actions under there. So why does your slide say there were 9 things identified as being subject to regional coordination?
There were 9 strategies under that implementation, under regional coordination.
The letters, A, B, C, D, E. Is that right, Allison? Did I get that right?
Yep. And I can pull that back up again if you want to see that.
4, 5, 6, 7. I've got it here in front of me. Okay. So I'm just trying to get the terminology right. So when you say a strategy,
totally fair.
You say a strategy, there could be like a strategy might be, let's just take the first one, building and permitting, develop standard approaches to incentivize green. Okay, but then there's three, what are you calling the three things under the strategies? Tasks or?
Actions. Those are actions that were approved to include in the plan.
Okay, 22 actions, 9 underneath 9 strategies, okay.
Yes, and a bunch of those actions and strategies, right, so are ongoing, are deal with programs that we already have, ongoing and existing programs. So a lot of the transportation actions, we already have a lot of regional programs where we do transportation planning. So that was seen as not necessary. We want to incorporate climate into those existing programs, but we don't necessarily need to do a lot to have a dedicated white paper on it. So
the things that Pamela brought forward to me was, and I agree with her, because she was thinking the electric vehicle infrastructure is something that the individual jurisdictions can work together and not require time for a white paper. That some of this is already undergone. We're already working with PSC. We're already looking at what our codes are going to need, and that we could do some, you know, information sharing between the jurisdictions and not spend our money and staff time on that white paper. She felt that that could be something that we start right now and work between the staff. And that was her opinion. She was very strong on one of the white papers being the regional program for carbon sequestration, because there are going to be so many things that are going to come out of the work that will inform policy, code, you know, the lenses we use for building and densifying and everything. And it just we don't have enough understanding right now for those action items. And so she was, and I agree with her. I've been saying this should be one of the white papers. And I understand that you, Allison, and her are going to be taking that course. Is that right? On sequestration. She felt that that might be what you learn out of that, a natural way to get some of that white paper to get done and then filling out, bringing in what other jurisdictions are doing. And then I'll just give you Jens, which is also another one of mine. How do we determine? I know that Lynn Fitzhugh sent us a list, and me a list about which one of these do have climate justice and social equity tags, but Yen felt we had not even begun to engage the communities we needed to engage to ensure that we actually had an adequate list of social justice and equity. She felt that potentially one of the other papers could be, how do we determine this? How do we get that conversation going? How do we get that communication going and the community buy-in for those people who are literally more worried about paying rent and medical bills and pills and getting their kids to school because they're on the edge in our community and have not ever been included in this conversation. So she felt that that might be a more important white paper. And I have to admit, I've kind of been worrying about that. So that's just where they're going. And they felt that the electric vehicle, now I will say, I agree with Ty. I was at that meeting that TCAT did. It was really well done. Their stakeholder group was really excellent. It was a broad breadth of people and there was a lot of good conversations. I'm kind of wondering, if we look at having TCAT continue that work and see what they could come up with and bring it back to this steering committee and not discarding the energy efficiency, but maybe redefining how we're going to do that part.
So
go ahead, Cynthia.
Well, I agree that EV infrastructure, I thought that was, for example, not the only thing that the code thing would do, frankly. But I agree that staff could talk about networking throughout Thurston County for EV infrastructure. I too think, even though I think TCAT tried to do that as far when we first started this, the plan was to reach out, but I think that is one of the bigger issues is trying to how to engage other people. And I would like to see a way of perhaps a paper on how best to do that and list several ways that jurisdictions could do that. Because I think that's one of my real fears too. We're way, way more diverse than Olympia. And I don't think we've engaged most of that group of community that needs to be involved. And we may even have a lot more lower income people too.
Well, actually, we just did an ecosystem for our economy and Olympia has twice the percentage of poverty compared to all the other jurisdictions. We're at 18% and all the rest are at 8 to 9%.
Okay. But that part I don't know, but I do know we're really diverse and I'm afraid our community has not, even though I think TRPC tried their best, I don't think we totally engaged them.
Pete?
So first of all, just a procedural question for Allison. Was TRPC anticipating doing all of these papers in parallel, more or less, or with different staff working on different topics, or is it all yours and it's pretty much each month take on one sequentially? How are you planning on doing this work?
We were planning on they would all go forward at once. It wouldn't all be me doing them. So it would be distributed across different staff, and some of those topics are, I think, more intensive than others, and some they're different. So they are kind of although all of them have their complexities. So the thought was they would all move forward on the same general timeline. Some might take a little bit less than others, but they'd be distributed.
Okay. That's what I thought, that these are different levels of effort depending on what you're looking at. I'll just take the EV one because it's a very specific one and it's probably something that I've thought a little bit about in terms of how this might be implemented. Is calling a house EV ready simply saying that you've got a receptacle where you could trickle charge an electric vehicle in your garage, or is it having a separate circuit breaker in your, you know, in your circuit box that is reserved for this? Or is it having a Tesla, you know, Tesla ready plug in your garage, you know, or some other electrical vehicle? There's no, the challenge with EV is it's not standardized, right? So there's different vehicles have different plug-ins. And so what does it mean for a house to be EV ready? I think that, I mean, it sounds simple enough, but I think there needs to be a little background work to kind of figure that out and give jurisdictions general guidance on what does that mean. And maybe it's already spelled out in state building code, or maybe Seattle's already figured it out and it's just a matter of looking it up. But it seems like, so that's an example of staff. And again, I think the level of effort for that one's pretty focused, pretty minimal. Probably they do that work and come back with a paper that says, here are your options. Here's what you can do. Here's what other people have done. Here's what the state code allows. And then we just go forward. You know, that's one that you knock off. The energy efficiency one, much more complicated. There's a lot of issues rolled into that. There's some issues, I think, about what our legal authority is, even in terms of whether we can require some of these things to be done. Keep in mind that just because Seattle or Portland are doing something, they are unique jurisdictions in terms of their legal authority compared to the rest of us. And so it doesn't, just because Seattle can do something doesn't mean that we can do it. We may need legislative authorization. So I think but that should come out of the analysis and look at and consultation with attorneys to some degree. The climate informed decision making one, I think, is a good one. But I think we also need to keep in mind that, you know, I see this all the time being on the administrative side of things. You know, you get public comment on a process and it says, well, this development is going to impact the climate, therefore you should deny it, right? Well, the code doesn't say that. What staff have to look at is, does it comply with our code, right? Mm-hmm. And so what I hope comes out of this is a general framework for how you evaluate whether a code is addressing climate or not, and not a specific project, because specific projects, again, rely on what's in the code to figure out what, you know, what's going on. And so I do think this is a, you know, when you look at the list as it's been spelled out by staff here at TRPC, it seems like the general categories that are identified are the logical ones that they should be working on, right? The transportation ones, we already know we're doing stuff in that area. I don't remember the others you had on your list there, but the others are more covered in some of the other tasks within the ILA, right? So, and in the charter. So it seems like this is a reasonable list to start with. I think, you know, one of the comments we got was, well, why don't you just ban gas? That's real easy. Well, I think we all agreed that that's probably not where we want to start, right? Because that's going to get everybody riled up, and then we're going to end up having failure. Let's look at places where we can have success and make progress and educate people so that when and if we do pull that one out of the list, that it's more likely to be successful and not result in a backlash that ends up throwing out the whole works. So you know, again, I think this is a reasonable place to start. But you know, I guess if people have other suggestions, I certainly would be interested in hearing them.
Carolyn,
I'd kind of like to go back to some of what you said and what Lisa and what Ty said. In terms of the EV infrastructure, certainly the charging stations, that might be located around Thurston County. I would really like us to take a regional look at that. And as those are being planned, have staff plot out for Thurston County a charging grid that makes sense so that you don't end up with a bunch of them bunched in Olympia and a bunch of them bunched in Lacey and then go for miles before you can find another one. It seems like this is the perfect forum, you know, and pulling this together to make something really make sense on this. The other thing in terms of outreach is I can tell you that we have communication staff for all of our jurisdictions have come together and formed a committee that's been working with the Regional Housing Council and cannot volunteer their time at this point, but I would love to pursue having them be available as needed to help us communicate out to the public when there are things to say, when there's a story to tell about actions that we're doing. I think outreach to certain groups is incredibly important. They can help with that, but they can also help us with news releases or forums or, you know, whatever function we might have. But I just don't want us to overlook that group of talent who might be accessible to us.
Very good, Carolyn.
Thanks.
Elaine?
Well, thank you. I'm still wrapping my head around the different, I'm back with Ty looking at the different pages, where we are focusing, where does my focus need to be looking at? Are we looking at the appendix 10.6? Is that, are these our targets then? Is this the, what we'll be working on? Like, is that, that's, okay. So this is what's all been dialed in. Are we limited just on to having four papers? Because again, the piece that was talked about that still comes out has been the part about engaging the community and the environmental justice piece of it. And so are we allowed to have more than four papers or?
I would say not under the current budget that you have approved.
Okay.
So if you wanted to do that, that's a great idea for something we could dive into, how to do a public outreach mm-hmm. effort. That really gets into questions of justice and equal representation, but we'd have to take something else off the list.
Okay.
But you do under task five have some time allocated to public outreach, right?
Yes. And money. But remember that budget for that is really small and limited, and we haven't talked about that task yet, but it's limited to a certain number of public presentations and maintaining the website.
But I guess my question too, though, is that, so we have these things that we want to put into place, but we don't, and so do we know how they will affect all factions of our population then? So before we start making these decisions, how do we know that? So
I think that's Jen's point is that, well, we've done very well, as good as we can. I know that TRPC has, I know TCAT has tried, but she feels that we haven't. And it's the same problem we're having with public safety. How do we get the portions of the community we need to hear from to come chat with us? And how do we need, you know, how do we engage them on what they feel? Because, you know, for example, as I heard from someone on climate justice, electric vehicle planning is great, but the average person we want to reach in that group will not be able to afford one for years to come, mm-hmm. much less afford to pay for the repair because you have to go to Seattle still. We have very few electric vehicle mechanics in town. So that's where, you know, that's where she's coming from. I hope I'm representing her well, but it's also my concern as well is that, you know, are we bringing the right voices into the room to help us prioritize some of this list of 72 actions. Cynthia?
So one of the things we could think about doing, it would add a little more complexity to the white papers, is add a lens of social justice every time we write one of the white papers.
And that's good.
That way you are forced to at least think about how that does it. I mean, for instance, if you're writing about networking and EV charging and stuff, you could talk about how there could be rebates for reselling of different vehicles. So eventually it works its way down to where somebody could buy a used electric vehicle that works still, and or a hybrid or whatever else. And, you know, that could be part of the paper about that, but, and it probably should be.
Yeah. That's good. Yeah, I also like to.
I just say, I agree. I think it makes sense as you look at each item to have to sort of, as you develop a proposal or as we develop a proposal, to sort of step back and go, okay, well, how does this impact low-income people? You know, or whatever other lens we need. But that, until you have a specific task, it's kind of hard to do that kind of analysis, I think.
Yeah, and I agree with you on the lenses, but if I could parrot Yen from our meeting, how do we make that lens accurate when we don't have those conversations already started with these portions of our community? Manros, how do you make sure that lens is actually fulfilling what they believe would be equity and social justice? Does that make sense? And to call it out, I mean, the diversity in climate action has not been super great until we get to the high school students, which it is very great if you go and participate in some of their meetings. But I'm just putting it out there, trying to parrot those conversations. But I want to go back to Ty's comments about building efficiency and how many people in our area, our partners, our private partners that we're doing this work, that maybe we could work with them instead of maybe doing the energy efficiency white paper, like tasking the point of sale group that TCAT has brought together to look at this kind of point of sale audit and then bring back to the steering committee potential actions. I don't know. I just want to put that out there. Ty?
Yeah, like I'm just, my reaction to I agree with most people's comments. I'm personally nervous about the building area, and I've been trying to attend webinars and stuff. I just counted, there's 27 actions related to buildings out of the 72. Yep. And a lot of them are really complicated. And what I've learned in all these webinars is how complicated they are. I mean, I've learned a lot about how to go about it, but there's a lot of pieces of it. And so I guess what I'm suggesting is that I'm pretty comfortable with these four white paper topics, but when it comes to that energy efficiency of residential buildings, I think we need to look a little deeper, look at these 27 strategies and figure out how we can unpack it and get as many of those strategies covered with some deeper understanding as possible, whether it's what you just said, Lisa, calling on a community group that's already going, or whether it's being more purposeful about the focus area of the white paper that we asked TRPC to do, and then look elsewhere. I mean, I'm gonna sit down with these 27 strategies and see if I can put them into some kind of, you know, categories to where we can break the work into chunks and get it properly allocated. This group can't figure out how to implement those 27 strategies, but we've got to do it. So we have to figure out the way to get it done.
And we have some of the experts in some of these codes and so forth. Yes, go ahead, Cynthia.
Well, I think our city has already done that and grouped them out and said where we're actually already implementing or starting the process or whatever else, because I have a list in front of me where we broke it down to try to think about how to move forward and stuff. And there's a few that said not yet or maybe too complex or something, but most of them we do. And I think that's an important for all jurisdictions to look through and see where they can where they have moved forward and where they can move forward.
So Chair, if I may, I just want to keep us on time, and I want to, this is really, really good discussion, and I want to see if we can come out with a partial or full decision on how we should move forward with this task. So I don't know what the best way to do that is. Maybe we could, so we have in our scope, we can do 4 white paper topics. We could walk through them from what I've heard one by one. We could, if we don't have consensus on some of them, we could come back and discuss it at the next meeting with some more information. But I would like to be able to walk out so I can start, as soon as we are able to start moving really on phase three, that I can start assigning tasks, and because some of these will take quite a while to get going. So if that's all right, I heard pretty general consensus for the carbon sequestration as a topic for the white paper. Mm-hmm.
That's what I was going to say. That one, it sounded like everybody agreed on.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I heard mixed on the other three. So we've got one. So I'll take the other three point by point, if this is okay. Just give me a sense with your thumbs up if you think one of the four should be around climate-informed decision-making. Thumbs up if you think one of them should be climate-informed decision-making. I got no thumbs.
I have a sideways thumb, I guess. If I'm confident that we're covering the building stuff adequately and there's an open white paper, I think it's a legitimate topic, but I'm nervous about covering the substantive areas. I mean,
yeah, I agree.
Yeah, it's so broad.
Mm-hmm. It's pretty big. And I will say for this one, and also I think for the, well, for actually probably all of them, all the topics are broad. We're not going to write the exhaustive, you know, textbook on how to do it. We're just going to see.
The end goal then on what would be the outcome, you know, what is the expected outcome on the white paper then for the climate informed decision? Is it dollars and cents, you know, to, you know, what are we looking at? What are we going to be providing? I guess is what I, what does that, what will that get us?
If we were to eliminate one of these, as Ty says, this building thing is huge. Mm-hmm. Might we have break that into 2 separate papers?
Sure.
Yeah, why don't we go through the other two and then just come back to that. How's that? And just see where the group is.
How about energy efficiency of residential buildings, which would kind of be taking all those actions and unpacking them a little bit and seeing, getting a little bit farther with that strategy.
Yeah.
I got thumbs up, thumbs up, thumbs up.
Yeah. I would add, as you look at them, think about this subgroup apparently that's already meeting out there, and
yes,
where they can, maybe they can provide some technical support on specific elements of that. So maybe you come back to the committee next month with, These are the areas we're going to bring in these other folks to, and these are the ones that we're going to research. That might be a way to start to get some progress moving ahead, but also take advantage of some of these outside groups. Lisa, if you're new, climate specialist has expertise in a particular area and they can do this, then they should be talking to Allison to say, hey, I can provide some help with this particular piece of this. Because I think TRPC is, even though it may look like a lot of money, they're going to run out of time and money here if we try and do every one of these.
I know that Climate Solutions is pulling together city staff from across the state of Washington to tackle some of this stuff and borrow from each other to build kind of a cookbook of what we can do and what jurisdictions can do. So some of this may already be underway, but I think, you know, I think this is the perfect place where we do maybe do a white paper, but we also break it apart and see what we actually need to do here and what is already being done. I think that's why she said something about the EV vehicles. She really felt that that was something that she felt that could be taken care of at the staff level without making it a white paper.
Maybe she does that background work for and talks to Allison and says, hey, I can do the background work on that, pull it together, and then TRPC can then adjust it as necessary to fit into the to the package, you know. So
okay, so on that point, let's go look at the electric vehicle ready infrastructure. Give me a thumbs up if you think that should be one of the four topic areas.
Yeah, I think so. Mm-hmm.
Only reason I'm doing it is because of what Pamela said to me. Mm-hmm. That's the only reason I'm doing this. Mm-hmm.
So I saw, I think everyone except Lisa with their thumbs up.
I've got a small thumb. It's there.
Carolyn, so just for point of order, we have double representation here from some
That's
folks.
Right.
So if you're the alternate, I'm going to look to the main, but feel free to persuade each other.
You're so right. Thank you.
Just Olympia on a sideways and on
the could I ask the committee if they'd be willing to have Allison have a conversation with Pamela to get a I wish she was here because she'd explain mm-hmm. why she said that mm-hmm. before we formally say that's a white paper. And if Pam Allison brings back information and you decide to do a white paper, that would be cool. I'll probably put a thumbs mm-hmm. up on that.
Okay. Sounds like a plan.
Put a tentative on that one. We'll come back mm-hmm. next month and talk about it. And I think we can also come back next month and talk a bit about what the scope for the energy and energy efficiency paper would be. So
that just leaves climate
informed decision.
We're not
going to move forward with climate informed decision making. What I heard was a proposal to do some research into how we would have a broad, equitable public engagement effort, what that would take. Does that encompass, I think, the suggestion that I heard? So who would be in support of having that as the white paper as an alternative to climate-informed decision-making, although that's not one of the actions in the plan, but that's certainly at your discretion to do.
Say that again. I'm sort of half listening.
So rather than climate-informed decision-making and the actions from the plan that it would unpackage a little bit, the alternative proposal that I heard was to do a white paper around how we might have a broad climate justice focused outreach effort, what that would take.
My position is going to be that we wait on this white paper and I want to see where the others land. And so I may or may not agree with what you just proposed, but I do agree that we should wait on this one and kind of see that we're comfortable. That gives us a little flexibility once we see where the other three land.
We'll just say, I mean, if you wait till the other three land, there might not be any time left in the.
I don't mean be done. I mean land in terms of just land in terms of scope, because you're going to bring back information about the building one, and Lisa's staff is going to talk about the electric vehicle. And I just want to be certain that mm-hmm. those land where we think they're landing in terms of scope.
Okay. So does that sound like we would come back? We would definitely be moving forward on the carbon sequestration white paper. We'd come back next month with sort of a scoped out what might be covered and talk a little bit more about the scope for an energy efficiency one. Mm-hmm. We'd come back next month to revisit the electric vehicle one, and you'd make a decision next month, hopefully, on on the mix, on the full mix of papers, whether that's a fourth paper, or you're putting more effort into energy efficiency, or doing an outreach specific paper.
So, quick question. So, rather than take those other three and try to look at it, including with the lens of social equity, you're just saying that that would be a separate paper.
I'm not saying it's an either or. I do think we could take that feedback, and for each of these papers, we talk about the equity impacts of the different options. That's something I think we can do in all the white papers. What I heard proposed was putting together a policy proposal for public outreach that engages different groups, how we would really do that on a broad scale regionally. Because you're absolutely right, we've not been able to do it with the resources that we've had to date, although we've tried different things. But okay, we could, like we would do with the other white papers, do some research, look at what other people are doing and what's working, look at what we have the capacity to do regionally and what it would take and who would be involved.
Okay.
So that is, we could do a white paper on that.
I'd like to
bring that back next month, maybe as an option, and you can make a decision then.
I like that. And I like Cynthia's suggestion of all the white papers, no matter what they are, we still have to come back with some kind of equity lens for them. So that's good. That's good. How does everybody feel?
Good.
Good.
Good. Yeah, okay. If I could just make one point on the equity, getting back to a comment Lisa had made earlier is about how we get them to come to us.
No, we're going to have to go to them.
Exactly.
Go to them.
Exactly.
It's going to have to be intentional.
Very much so. I mean, and this kind of gets to the heart of racism. You know, we just make those assumptions, and I don't mean to single Lisa out by any stretch, but I think we're going to bring that into our thinking as we try to address this work and look for opportunities to meet them where they are, where they gather.
It's okay to bring it, to call it out, because that's the kind of conversations we should be having, Carolyn. I don't mind you calling it out, because it should be an intentional reach in and ask for them to join us. It shouldn't be us waiting for them to come. So you're absolutely right. Cynthia.
So many years ago, I belonged to the International Association of Impact Assessment. I was on the group of reaching out to people. And so you're dealing with tribes, dealing with indigenous groups, et cetera, all over the world. And that's one of the things is, you can't assume they'll come to us. You have to go to them where they are, and you have to sit down and whatever it takes with people that are leaders and help go around that. So my assumption is it includes churches, it includes social gatherings where they're at, et cetera. But that's the thing that I think it's hard to do, but maybe needs to be put into some kind of a paper to show where we can make an impact.
Thank you all for that guidance. I'm going to go quickly through our last two tasks in phase three
Before you did, could you just sort of maybe put together a couple sentences on what this alternative white paper would be for the next time?
So for next time, what we would do is bring back a more fleshed out and talked about the scope for the energy efficiency white paper and an alternative white paper that would look at what would be some options and what would be necessary to do a broad outreach, public outreach and engagement work regionally to engage disadvantaged groups and include them in our decision making around climate work. How's that? And we may substitute that for the decision making white paper. Okay. Okay. Task four in the interlocal agreement is monitoring an assessment program. And so part of what we'll be doing for that is, it's the same as all the other white papers, looking at other examples out there of who's doing monitoring, fleshing out what it would take for us to do a regional monitoring program for our climate work, and coming up with a plan that you would include in the long-term agreement for how you want to monitor long-term. And well, this year it would just be a pretty more qualitative, I think, except for the metrics that we already measure, looking at our annual progress report. And then finally, task five, we talked a bit about is public outreach. And this public outreach, I completely agree. It's a huge topic. It's a huge need. We have very, very small scope and very small budget for this in phase three in our local agreement. So we'll be updating the climate website at TRPC to kind of have it be focused on implementation work. I'm hoping we'd be able to use it for reporting out what all of your jurisdictions and our other partners in the community are doing so that people can go there and get routed out to find if they, as they want to get involved, find opportunities. And then we have some budget to do presentations to community groups. We've gotten a lot of requests to come and present to groups. Some of that is going out to the groups, those communities, where they're at, where they're meeting, instead of waiting for them to come to us. We also discussed using some of this budget to develop a short video that would be on the website that we could use to just talk about the climate plan. So that's task five.
Could I, one of the things that occurred to me for task one with the staff group would be to put a conversation forward for the staff to discuss how we could use our already existing communication processes in all the jurisdictions to help make task five a little bit more meaty, maybe potentially, or maybe go farther, because it is a small budget and yet it's a very, very important part of the plan.
Yeah, I'm sure hoping Olympia staff can do all of this, because we got nothing. We got no horsepower left. And we got one person, and she's like way overbooked right now. So.
And we just hired a new communication person. So.
Good for you.
Yeah, I don't know. It may not be possible, but if there is the capacity to at least be the push out into the community as the TRPC comes up with something communication-wise, using our jurisdictions, Facebooks and websites and everything, is to push this, help push for the TRPC.
So we have set it up and they're starting on something like that through our public affairs department, I believe. And so, you know, online open house survey, engaged ways for local organizations, et cetera. So we'll see where it goes, but I don't think it'll be enough. It's a great start, but it doesn't, what if you don't have a computer? I think.
Yeah, right. So, good point.
Yeah, and we can certainly post stuff on our webpage and, you know, link to Facebook and other things, but I, you know, in terms of doing original work, I think we're going to be pretty limited in what we can do in that regard. So I did want to just go back to task four and clarify. So Allison, I know this was debated, but at this point, there is no expectation to even just plug into the ICLEI model updated numbers to get a new inventory for this year or this last year?
So doing the inventory is not part of TRPC's scope of work. However, okay. I have talked with TCAT and they are intending to continue to do the greenhouse gas inventory for another year at least. So
that would be great. I think that's...
So we'll continue to use that when we provide them a lot of the information for that and we'll continue to use it.
Yeah, I think that would be important to continue that if we can, but this really speaks to broadening that analysis beyond that, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Although part of it would be scoping out what it would be to take over that work and not, because presumably if someday TCAT maybe doesn't want to do that for free anymore,
right?
And what that would mean.
For some reason, I thought that was going to be TRPC's scope of work to do that, to TCAT was going to give it to you to do.
I thought so too.
It was discussed as part of phase three, but I think there was the decision was made to not put more of the budget into the policy research versus monitoring.
Yeah.
I did think there was it wasn't that we would do it in phase three, but we would get what it would take and the cost that it would put on the regional process.
Yes.
We'll have to do that to build it into phase four, so.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is a near-term priority for us as part of phase three to scope this out. I'm going to close that. And we can certainly keep discussing the phase three tasks. This is a really good, thank you all for your updates, but I know we have other things we want to talk about. And thank you for your comments.
That was good. That was really good. We're going to agenda item. These are the standing agenda items. And as I understand them, the legislative, and Ty and Allison can correct me from our agenda setting, legislative updates will not just be potentially for during session, but what bills look like might be dropped next year and how regionally can we help. The grant and other funding opportunities would be something that comes along, like finding out from Pamela Braff that FEMA now has a new fund that may be able to be tapped into for climate work as well as sea level rise. I forget the name of it, she has it, but it's a brand new one and it's based on the percentage of FEMA funds from the year before. And then the last one is the jurisdictional information sharing, which we want to be more meaty than we did in the steering committee two, right? Phase two, did I get that right? Because you know, we've got a whole segment of the 72 that the individual jurisdictions will be responsible for. So go ahead and take it, Allison, and go ahead and I think we got a legislative, is it Karen is going to be doing the legislative update? Thank you.
Do you want to share your screen, Allison, please?
Can you guys see it? Yeah.
Yes.
So I just wanted to let you know that, just to remind you that what I sent you is basically inaccurate by the time you get it. So I'm trying to stay on top of the changes in the legislative session. So next slide. We are, I just wanted to give you a sense of where we are. Started January 11th. We're coming up on another deadline on the 26th. And that would be opposite house bills being reported out of program committees and then opposite house bills being reported out of fiscal committees. Next slide. The budgets came out today, the transportation budgets, and my understanding is that they would like to actually pass it by the 29th. So although the revenue forecast is up, the transportation pieces are not. I'm guessing we're going to see a big bunch of bills hit being dropped now. So usually when the budget comes out, we see a bunch of new bills. We have no idea with transportation if we're going to be seeing just the biennium. What we've seen so far is just the biennium, or we're going to see a bigger package. That bigger package did include some information about electric vehicle infrastructure and the like. Next slide. So I have not added budget sections yet because they just started coming out, but in addition to that big long list I gave you, there's probably another 50 bills that could support climate strategies. So there's a lot of interest in broadband, and you make that second step that says if we want to have people work remotely, then they need to have broadband. So I just thought I would walk through the bills that I sent you this morning. Do you have that up? Allison, the list of bills. And I'm not walking through every one, but I guess for me, I'm wondering what you want to see. This will give you a sense by having the categories of bills of the kinds of bills that we're seeing that are happening. So you saw that there was electric vehicle infrastructure, there was different taxes and the like supporting electric vehicles. But there's also quite a bit on climate and energy. What hasn't happened is the bills that have been introduced about climate and buildings, they really haven't gone anywhere. But my understanding is they're going to start moving now, now that we're starting to see budgets. So basically what this says is, you know, here's the bill number, here's the status of where it is. All of these bills are still alive as of this moment. I included the sponsor if it included a local sponsor. So if we see some bills here that you're really interested in hearing about or saying, please help push this bill, that we know who we would want to talk to. And so because of time and because it would just be boring, I wasn't going to go through each of these bills. I just wanted to provide you with this list, see if you had questions. If there are ones that you see on this list that you would like to weigh in on, one of the things that's great about this year is you can very easily sign on to be for or against a bill without going to the legislature. Just make it happen that way. So I'm happy to sign you in as being supportive of a bill. I know we did this before. Pete provided some written testimony. So what I would say sort of in general is there's a lot of interest in climate in the legislature. There is still a lot of pushback. So some of these bills that we are seeing party line divisions about, that still we have some folks who are thinking climate change is not something we should be spending money or time on. I guess the other thing we are hearing a lot about, as you mentioned earlier from the building industry, is this question about affordable housing and improving energy efficiency in buildings. And so I'm going to see if there's questions.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
Because I belong to Climate Solutions, somebody asked me to make sure that our senators would support 5091, I think it is. And that's the climate standards bill, I think.
Okay, I'll look that up. I don't think it's on the list because I think it wasn't moving.
Isn't the House Bill 1091? Isn't that what it is?
I think
but
so.
1091, not. But I ever said 1591. Yes, 1091.
Okay, my understanding is it's not moving right now. So we were trying to capture bills that are actually moving. So there's a number of bills that, according to the cutoff schedule, they really are dead.
Okay.
But my guess is they're hanging out there just waiting to come alive again. So this is the time of session that starts happening. So I did not track those bills that didn't make it through the cutoffs, but I will add that one to it.
The clean fuel standard bill.
It's okay. Yeah, it's on your second page, I think.
Okay. I just couldn't remember if it's there. And this is obviously in issue order. It can also be in bill number order if you want to do that. It's a simple word table. So I guess I want from you guys a little more information on what you'd like to see. I can produce this and send it out to you, as we get to cutoffs. And I am looking for what are some things we can be looking at for next session, because it's late this session to add much, unless you can see some interesting places to hang an amendment. I think there might be some places that we could see that. In addition, there are equity bills all over. So there are equity bills about education, medical, science, almost everything. And so while I didn't include all of those on here, those are out there. So I guess I'm looking to you to say, is there something you'd really like to get done this session, and therefore we should find a place to hang it on a bill? Or are we just really looking at what's the mood out there and what is passing and what does it mean for our future legislative package?
I know that we just put through CPACER, but it would be interesting to see what they were doing with the PACER, which is for single family dwellings and smaller commercial and below 4 apartment buildings, because it is a unique way to fund some of these upgrades, these building upgrades that make it accessible to families and smaller landlords. Mm-hmm. I know that the county is working on CPACER, but it would be interesting to see where the legislature is going on that, because we also have to keep in mind that some of the things that may require legislatively, regionally, we need to be able to help the people that will have to pay for it.
Yes.
Get it done. Mm-hmm. And so I'd be interested in those kinds of bills as well.
Okay. The other thing we've certainly heard from the building trade is the idea that often the benefits that come from energy efficiency, because tenants pay utilities, go to the individuals and not to the builder. And so having those conversations about how we get winning strategies that support both sides, I think will be difficult. But one thing about the legislature is you have a pretty broad range of opinions. And so when you look at the legislation, you get some sense about, how people are feeling about some of these bills. And I make a real point to look at the testimony and see who's for it and against it, because I think those are potential conversations we can have. If we find that the building industry is really supportive of this, but they're really negative about this, it tells us what we have to do in our own community to have conversations before you want to introduce something.
The other one would be preeminence. If there looks like there's something that's going to come into the session next year that would preempt local jurisdictions doing something, for example, gas bans.
Yep.
And that kind of segues to what I definitely want to make sure that is presented to us at these meetings is things that are going to directly impact the work we're doing in our jurisdictions. If we're, if we're knee deep in some policy, but the state's got a bill that's going to basically do the same thing statewide, then I want to know that. And that could easily slip by me. And then with this long list of bills, that this tracker shows how hard it is.
Oh, it is hard to take care of, but I wanted to give you guys a sense at this first meeting of just the very different ways that we're looking at climate and the bills that are impacting it.
I mean, your point, Karen, is I just keep making it everywhere I go, because it's the affordable housing defense, I call it. I don't hear in Washington, thank goodness, we have, a lot more reasonable people on both sides of the aisle. And, I don't hear that climate change isn't real. I don't hear that these things can't be done technologically. What I hear is we can do them, but it's going to drive up the cost of housing, and we're having an affordable housing crisis. and so we shouldn't do them. That's mm-hmm. and so that's where we have to, as we develop these mm-hmm. things, that's what we have to be ready to answer. Mm-hmm. And that's what we have to work on to make the policies better too, so that they're meeting those, because those, I mean, there's a nugget of legitimacy in that concern that I want to meet, mm-hmm. but I also don't want that to be a defense to you know, our other goals.
Mm-hmm. Right on. That's really yeah. good.
Okay, well, I will keep putting things together. If I see bills that are like, oh my gosh, everyone has to know about this right now, I'll be happy to just send a blast out. But there's a lot out there. This is not only a Thurston County issue, obviously.
And I think that goes to, I'll just piggyback on what Ty was saying and what you actually brought up, Karen, which is, you know, it may extend into renter protections and so forth for, you know, where do mm-hmm. the benefits of this go? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I agree.
Okay, well, I will send you things as they come along and look for opportunities for sort of those broader issues that aren't just about a specific piece of legislation. I'll also find out, I've been starting to work with some of the climate lobbyists on both sides to get a sense of what kinds of work they'll be doing during the interim and what the subject matter they see coming out of the this session.
Thank you, Karen.
Sure.
That's a lot of work. Granting and other funding opportunities, I'm going to make a jump that we don't really have a lot of that right now. Is that right, Allison? Okay. Yep. So does anyone have any jurisdictional information sharing we could do briefly? We've only got 5 minutes. If people don't mind going longer, we can share more. Thumbs up on we want to make it brief or we want to go longer. I think that's yes or no. I guess, do we mind going longer? Thumbs up. All right, I'm not seeing any. Oh, thumbs up, okay.
Okay. I feel bad because I had Brad's been hanging in to our meeting and I was wondering how he was gonna report for Tumwater. So
I'm fine with
thanks for hanging in, Brad.
We're making progress and I will leave it.
I linked him in.
Well, thank you.
Right. maybe what we could do, because sort of like what we do with our public comment period, if we can't get to a full report out from jurisdictions, if we could just get a one pager, you know, bullet point something, so that we can all see and it can be shared. Does Lacey, I know that Cynthia, you said you printed off something. Do you want to share?
Yes, very briefly. I have actually, we have a list of what is ongoing and not, and where we are in the progress of all these tasks. But also, I think I mentioned very briefly about engaging the public. And so we're in the process of creating an online open house, a survey, engaging in a focused way with a number of our local jurisdictions. And then we've put together something for our planning commission, which can review the public participation plan. And I think it was March 22nd that the commission was going to look at it. And so I'm not sure what they've done with it, but we're going to do this for April. It doesn't quite get at everything I personally talked about and you've personally talked about, but it's definitely a start on our public outreach. And we're actually having conversations with the council, which is going to be talking about the plan and engaging the public, which I'll be part of.
Excellent.
That's it.
I had one question for Tumwater. I understood you all were going to be hiring a part-time or half-time sustainability staff member. Is that correct? Are you still on doing that?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we are. We were talking about trying to move up that hire date if we could, but that we are still looking at that position. I think they were looking at, I think Mayor, correct me, but I think it was until summertime, but we were trying to, or fall, but trying to move it up if we could, so.
Yeah, we're behind, but we just got a lot of other hires and, mm-hmm. you know, one person to do all the work. So it's going to take us a while to actually get the ability to do that. I think we had it scheduled for September, if I recall.
Yeah, it was fall because we're going to be doing the urban forestry and then the other piece of it too. Right.
Thank you. And then my only other question, Lacey, Cynthia or Carolyn, do you have a projected time when the Planning Commission might put this into your comp plan or work towards that?
Yes, June, I think. Okay. That is, at least that's how the Planning Commission has been set up to do that. Right. And I think they're making good progress. Isn't that what you think too, Carolyn?
Yes, and then it's scheduled to come to council in July.
Okay. Ty.
So I'm just gonna make one point, which is that to remind the my partner jurisdictions that the county responded last summer to TCAT's proposal to launch a community-wide energy efficiency program. And we set aside $37,500 and we kept that money earmarked. And we asked, and then the jurisdictions didn't bite on that offer. But then we said, then TCAT came back to the county and said, well, will you take your money and hire a consultant to design a program that then we could launch at a later point? And the county commissioner said, if the other jurisdiction, if we will do that, if the other jurisdictions will at least say that they want to, you know, join this effort in the future and will agree to provide information to the consultant to help design the program as a regional program. We got a very enthusiastic letter from Olympia. Thank you very much. So which on the, and I received that on March 5th. I think Lacey wanted to wait, and I'm not sure if Tumwater responded or not, but I guess I want to throw that back out there. We are still willing to launch a design of this program. And I think as you look at your binders and all the building related strategies, I think we can all agree that we could really benefit from this as a way to move these strategies forward. And the county's got the money to get the design going, but we wanted to hear that the other jurisdictions would be wanting to join us at some future point. So now that you've kind of seen what the steering committee's got on its plate, and you've got your to-do list, so to speak, maybe you guys could, I'm just asking you to maybe revisit that and think about whether that's the thing you'd like to help us participate in. If I get thumbs up, then I'll take it back to County Commission and get the program design moving. Thank you.
We're not there yet, Ty. Sorry, we just aren't. And not until we get our thing adopted into our comp plan and know where we're going is sort of how we're looking at it.
I mean, from my perspective, if we get back from TRPC, here's a list of things that we want them to do, and we can write a scope of work around that. Then it's a little bit different. What I saw was so general. I just didn't see it helpful. So
yeah, they never gave us an actually RFP writing out specifics and stuff, in my opinion, with costs and stuff. And
so maybe next month, if we get a little more refined list here, then we can start. They can cost it out. We can start talking turkey. We do have some money set aside, but we also have some other initiatives internally going on. So I'm just not sure how much money we have to put forward yet.
Well, and you know, they came back with a proposal. Well, you know, if you can't give us money, then give us your staff time. And Lacey, that our staff is just stretched beyond what's reasonable already. And so that's where some of the resistance is coming up. I mean, I've would find it easier to throw $40,000 at this than I would staff time at this point, but I'm not sure we can bring around the rest of the council on that. Cynthia, I don't know if you want to add anything to that, but
That's exactly right. And that's always been our whole problem with a lot of these initiatives and stuff. It takes staff, and we're in the middle of working on our comp plan. We're in the middle of some other things that we're really trying to get done, and they can only do so much, and we cannot afford to hire anyone.
I'm just going to ask you to look at the 27 strategies or actions related to energy efficiency in buildings. And if you have a better approach for how to get those implemented consistently across the region, I'm happy to hear that and put my $37,500 towards something else. But it's going to take a lot of work to get those strategies dialed up and regionally coordinated. Just think about that. It's going to have to happen one way or the other, or I'm going to keep getting angry with you guys.
Go for it. You go.
Yeah, that's good. I love it. Yeah, we, Pamela Breff seems pretty excited about it. And it's nice because, you know, let's put it this way, an earthquake gave us Pamela, because the earthquake that destroyed our bridge that we had to rebuild is the budget line item that is paying for Pamela. So in a weird way, an earthquake helped us get to a climate coordinator. But I will say in Olympia, one, the big deal is that she's finally in Olympia. She's made her move fully across the country. She's here. She's actually unpacking her moving truck today. That's why she's not here. So yay. She's already come up with a Earth Day resolution that's going to commit the city to certain actions. So look for that. She's pretty impressive. She's already worked together to get across the silos of the city, bringing together a climate team. And then the city council put together a requirement that all staff reports not only have to have equity, but climate lens. So, you know, even if we're repairing a sewer, how is that going to help the climate plan? Just, you know, does it have an impact or not? And then I was able to get into the 2022 budget a part-time help for Pamela so she can do some more lifting. Now, just to let you know, the way we look at it, because we stole from Lacey the ADU plans, that anything that we put forward and we figure out, we're more than willing to share out to everybody, because we're not above stealing from the other jurisdictions to get stuff done, like Tumwater with the renter protection. So, you know, it goes around, comes around, just to let you know.
Lisa, they were not stolen. They were joyfully shared and given.
See, and we'll share.
Available to Tumwater and Thurston County too.
Oh, wait a minute, we had to pay for that. Nothing was given to us there, so.
What?
Just keep that in mind in the future, that, you know, as a region doesn't mean we have to do it all independently. Sometimes we can help each other, so. I just wanted to put that there. And I know that's how Pamela feels too. Okay, anything else? Okay, do we have any more public comment? I think we got everybody in the beginning.
See, Carolyn, for public comment additionally, we did have one extra person show up, but they've already left.
Okay. Okay, well done, you guys. This is the first one of phase three, yay. I look forward to working with all of you. You're all very bright and passionate, and I look forward to what we're gonna get done in 12 months. So thank you.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
All right, thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks, Allison.